Hello? It's beautiful Tuesday night as always, and I'm excited to be here as always, and I want to welcome you guys to tonight's show, Intimate Talk with Dr. Tolu. This is your number one love show on your number one radio station, 99.3 Nigeria Info, where every effort will make every attempt, every effort, every decisions, everything that is being done on this station is all about making sure your life is better. It's all about making sure you are happier. Nigeria Info is passionate about the listeners, just as Intimate Talk with Tolu is passionate about making sure that you are happy. All right? Okay, so tonight I have a topic that I packaged for last week. And as a result of a lot of things that were happening, I decided not to take that and talk about why I think you need a counselor. And I'm going to be starting tonight's episode on that note. You see, as a professional counselor, I see a whole lot. You know, I see a lot. And, you know, now, the job of a counselor is not to tell people what to do. The job of a counselor is to help people to realize, you know, the options they have and the consequences of each of the actions. So if you are taking option A, these are the things that could happen to you. If you are taking option B, these are the possible consequences. That is the job of a counselor. And I noticed that in this part of the world, because we are not so good at talking to professionals, it's not a thing, you know. People feel like, why do I need to talk to a counselor? Well, I can talk to my mom, while I can't. I talked about all that last week. But something happened this week, and, you know, it made me, I want to start tonight's show on that note. That, you know, sometimes that's where I'm going. As a professional, like I said, my job is not to tell you what to do. I can't impose my belief or my decision. Whatever I think you should do, I can't impose it on you. But I will open your options for you so that whatever decision you are making, whatever step, you know, that is the only way. That's why I tell couples, you know, married people that are fighting, probably fighting about sex, fighting about cheating. You are trying to change your husband or you are trying to change your wife. It won't work. People don't change as adults. You can't change anybody unless they make up their mind to change. So now, if you are fighting, if you are nagging, you are crying, you are inviting families, just because you want to change your husband or you want to change your wife, it's not going to work until that man make up his mind to change, or until the woman make up her mind, like, okay, I need to change. But people don't get to that point of making up their mind until you give them reasons to do so. That is why you need to talk to. It is the job of a professional counselor or a therapist or a psychologist to make that person get to that point where he will be able to make up his or her mind, this is what I want to do. You know, so it could be a difficult position when you notice that this person is trying to make a wrong decision and you don't want to impose, you know. Sometimes, you know, counselors, that's why some people say counselors are like, they're like herbalist, you know. You know, they could. It's possible to be able to see the future. It's possible, you know, from if I have sessions with my client, I could tell if you take it this way. This is it's. I don't know. Maybe, you know, I've developed the skills over the years, you know, so I could tell that if you take option A, this is what is going to happen to you. If you take option B, this is what is going to happen to you. So I could see, but I know that. At that moment, let me give you an example. For example, maybe a woman is telling you, Dr. Tolu, I want to leave my husband. I don't want to marry my husband again. I'm done. I'm tired. Probably she's seen someone and she's so excited about that person. She think she's in love with that person. She's so excited that everything that is coming to her head is how to leave her husband and go to that person. She's enjoying it and you know everything. She's happy. I mean, love could be very powerful. If it is love or whatever, you know. At that point, where that woman is enjoying all the euphoria of whatever she's feeling, if you try to tell her that if you take this path, you're going to regret, she can never listen to you. And that is where the professional comes in. That's why even if your pastor is telling you, your mom, everybody, the person will be looking at, what are they saying? Because she can't see, because she's excited where she is. Now, as a professional, I could see that where she's headed to might not pay her later. Maybe in the next 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 years, she might regret that action. Even as a dad, I still can't tell her, don't do it. I can't say point blank, because if I say it, I will be behaving like her friends or family. Now, my job is to now make her, you know, try to put together a program, you know, a kind of counseling program, a package for that person. Now, and I will test my package towards making her see that this thing could be dangerous. So at the end of the day, if the counseling is done properly, it is most of the time, 90% of time, the client will turn towards the right place. But sometimes, maybe 5-10%, the client, even knowing that this is wrong and this could be the consequences, it's possible for the client to tell you, I don't care. I know this is what is going to happen, but that is what I want for myself. Now, why am I saying all this? Sometimes counselors or therapists find themselves in difficult situations because you don't want to impose on people, because if you are doing that, you are doing the same thing that the families have been doing, or the wife, the husband, and it has not been working. Now, the point here is this. If you are listening to me tonight and you are making a decision, a serious decision, especially when it has to do with emotion, when it has to do with relationship, it's powerful. When it has to do, in fact, when it has to do with man and woman, I don't understand. You see, I've seen a lot as a marriage counselor, as a sex therapist, I've seen a whole lot. And I understand that it could be the place of a man and a woman. It could be clumsy, it could be ununderstandable, it could be something you can't explain. So if you are listening to me tonight and you are trying to make a drastic decision, please think twice. Think twice before you make a decision that tomorrow you will now regret. You can't come and say, oh, it's a counselor that tell me to do that. You won't be able to do that, because the counselor is going to expose all the options to you. So please, and probably what you need to do, if this decision is very serious, maybe you are thinking divorce, separation, whatever, please talk to a specialist, talk to a counselor before you take that decision. And when a counselor tells you, let's do it this way, don't abandon the program, because if you do, the consequences might not be palatable. And it's on that note I'm starting tonight's episode of Intimate Talk with Dr. Tolu. And of course, if you are just joining me, this is the best thing that has ever happened to radio. Here on this show, we build homes, we mend relationships, and we fix sexual issues. We talk about stories that affect people's lives, and it is part of the world people are afraid to talk about it. We understand that about 75-85% of marital problems are sexual related. So why are we not going to talk about it? So tonight, I'm going to be talking about a very nice topic. You're going to enjoy it. And of course, if this is your first time of tuning in, my name is Dr. Tolu. I'm a clinical relationship and marriage counselor. I'm a sex therapist and I'm a matchmaker. A trained one. I know my onions. I am not bragging. So you're welcome to my show. Whatever you are getting on this show is professional tips that I'm going to be giving you. It is not hearsay. It is not what I just read. So just understand that, of course, it's out of research. It also out of dealing with so many clients for my 15 years of practice. And of course, from experience, from research, from other people's research work as well. So whatever you are getting from me, believe it, is authentic. So tonight, you're welcome to my show. You could actually go to Facebook and watch me live. I think I should be live on Facebook. So just search out for Nigeria Info on Facebook and join me right there. And of course, you could watch me live on TV on Wazobia Max. If you're on DSTV, it's on channel 259. So you don't have an excuse. You don't have any excuse for your marriage not to be beautiful, for your relationship not to be doing well. So tonight, I'm talking about the perfect French kiss. And like I usually say on my show, you could actually get your pen and paper. You know, sometimes, most of these things, you know, you have been married for 10, 15 years, and you've not been doing all these things. And then Dr. Tolu just came and say, oh, come on, you need to do it like this. And then you say, oh, I like, you know, I enjoy Dr. Tolu. I like the way she talks. And then I will do everything she said. And you just listen. The possibility that you won't be able to be consistent, and you could even forget all these things, is very high. So the best thing to do is to get a pen and a paper, you know, like all this sticker. You could stick it to your mirror, to your drawer in the office, so that you could be looking at the points and be, you know, looking at them, reading them till they become a part of you. All right, so tonight you don't have to move a muscle. You could actually send, you know, broadcast, tell people that you care about. If you have a couple that are battling with issues in their relationship or in their marriage, you could actually tell them to tune in. This is the best place anyone could be. Relationship, you know, your relationship is your life. I usually say that your relationship is your life. So quit all this pretense that it doesn't matter, I'm living my life. No, you can't live your life. You can't be happy in a bad marriage. It's not possible. You can't be in a bad relationship and your life will be moving on well. It's not possible. You'll be living in anger. You'll be living, you know, a life that you were meant to deserve better. I don't know the right way to put that. You know, you'll be living like half or a quarter of the quality of life that you are supposed to be living. So tonight, I want to talk about kissing, because I understand that a lot of couples are battling. You know, these things look so little, but because we neglect them, we don't take cognizance of them. You know, at the end of the day, you know, a little one there, you don't kiss, you don't peck, you don't send romantic texts, you don't no foreplay. You know, little things. You don't compliment. You don't give her sweet nothing, like I usually say. And you know, you're just living your life as if those things don't count. At the end of the day, you will discover that all these little things that you are neglecting, they will come together, and your marriage must have gone very bad before you realize that things are getting worse. So you need to take this serious. Kissing might look like, oh, it doesn't count, it doesn't matter. It's a big deal, and I need you to realize that tonight. All right? So I'm talking about French kiss. So what is French kiss? Huh? Okay, so I wrote it here. Wikipedia says a French kiss is known as a deep kiss. It's an amorous kiss in which the participants' tongues extend to touch each other's lips or tongue. It's a kiss with the tongue. You know, you stimulate the partner's lip, the tongue, the mouth, which are sensitive to touch and induce psychological sexual arousal. So now, let me explain that to you. So when we are talking about, I think I have a book on kissing, right? I have a book on kissing. It's not published, but you could actually download it on my website. You can download the soft copy. It's a very short book that I wrote on kissing. Now, there are different type of kisses, you know, and they mean different things. You know, a kiss at the back of the hand, a kiss at the forehead, a kiss at the cheek, at the neck, at the back of the neck. You know, all of them has different meaning. There are different, I think, like 30 or 40 different kind of, 50 different types of kisses. You know, so pecking, kissing, necking, you know, different types of kisses, you know. But now, if you talk about French kiss, you need to understand that French kiss brings about, it induces psychological sexual arousal. Now, you can't French kiss and not feel something, a tingling feelings, you know, a kind of arousal. There is no way you will French kiss and you won't feel it, you know. So I understand that in this part of the world, people don't kiss. You know, it's like it's a foreign, you know, I could remember, I mean, this is a very funny one, and I don't want to go into detail, but something somebody said, and it baffles me because this is someone, no, let me not go into that, but the person said, why should I kiss now? And what's all that? I've never seen my father kissing my mother. And then you can imagine, you know. So people don't kiss because we believe, oh, it's foreign, it's not Nigerian. And I tell people, I mean, you are saying it's foreign, it's not Nigerian. Everything is changing. Nobody is doing the building you are staying, the electronics, the technology, the clothes, even the clothes you are wearing. Everything has changed from the way it used to be 100 years or 50 years ago. And then you want to still make your relationship to be the way it was. It's not possible. So you are like trying to bring a new wine in an old bottle. It's not gonna work. So kissing is very essential. So French kiss, like I said, is a deep kissing that induced sexual arousal, and it involves the mouth, your mouth, your tongue, your lips are all involved when it comes to French kissing. Now, funny enough, when couples come to my office and when they want to leave after my session with couples, you must kiss. And I realized that most couples, I mean, at that point we would have been done with the session. So of course, if they were fighting before they came, the fighting would no longer be there, all right? So but at this point, they would have settled all their differences. And if I say, oh, okay, now you need to kiss, they have to kiss before they leave my office. And most time you see people blushing, people that have been married for 10, 15 years, you see them blushing, you see them acting funny, you see them like, don't worry, we'll kiss at home. I say, no, it's under Moses compulsory. At least this one thing you must do compulsorily. Everything in my office is voluntarily, but kissing before leaving my office is compulsory. So I tell them to kiss. But you notice that they're always blushing, they're always like, feeling. So I, most of the time I excuse them and I give them time. It's just a minute kiss. For 60 seconds, you need to kiss. And I realize that kissing is what a lot of couples don't do. It has taken the backstage in a lot of marriages. And I usually say that on this show. I've said it severally that most people, the last time they kissed was when the pastor says, okay, you may kiss your bride in the church. Okay, couples, okay, now I pronounce husband and wife, you may kiss your bride. That was the last time. Some people are lucky the last time they kissed was during the honeymoon. And after that, in fact, when the wife is coming to kiss the husband, the man, or the husband is coming to kiss the wife, to couples in Nigeria currently, not everybody, but a whole lot, it look awkward. One of my clients has told me that it look awkward because we don't do it. So if he's bringing his mouth and he's trying to kiss me, it look awkward. You know, you can imagine. All right. So that is what French kiss is all about. And of course, why are they calling it French kiss? It's just because French, you know, the French has the reputation, you know, of these adventurous, passionate kisses. You know, the French are known to kiss passionately. So, and it was in the beginning of the 20th century when kissing was even not so, the passionate kiss wasn't so popular in Europe, in France, they were all already kissing permanently, adventurous. They believe that people kiss as a form of adventure. All right, so that was why it's called a French kiss. All right. Now, when you are kissing, the next thing you want to do is, okay, kiss, and then you pull away. But when it comes to a French kiss, a lot are involved. You don't put your mouth and pull away just like that. All right. Okay, now kissing is an act of foreplay. All right, kissing can funny enough, people don't understand. Like a lot of men that are telling me, I'm always begging my wife for sex. I'm yeah, I'm always begging. If you know how to kiss a woman, kissing alone can make her to want to take it a step further. I'm talking about French kiss. Not pecking, not just touching the lips, but French kiss involving the mouth, the tongue, the lips. And not just that, involving every part of you. I'm going to be talking about that in a moment. So, if you are begging your wife for sex and she's saying, I'm not interested, maybe you should try stepping up your kissing game. Maybe you should try doing something about the way you kiss. All right? So now, kissing is interesting. It's actually biblical. So if you want to be so religious, let me just say that you are so religious and you feel like, you know, it's biblical. So, and of course, kissing, there is the power of touch. I've talked about oxytocin a lot on this show. And kissing, when you French kiss, it just doesn't involve just your mouth. I was telling one of my friends and her husband that they should come and demonstrate this thing for me. And I tell my husband, babe, can you come now? Let's kiss. You know, like, are you all right? I wish I could demonstrate this for you, but don't worry. Just pay attention. You will understand, okay? So French kiss actually involve caressing. So the power of touch. That's why, you know, you can't underestimate the power of touch. That's why couples who make love without touching are missing a lot. That's why if you notice children who are craving for touch when they are kids and there is nobody to pet and touch them, they always grow up with low self-esteem most time. They grow up becoming bullies, you know. And you just it's a research that has been done that there are a lot that touching does for kids or babies when they are small, right? Now, if you have been kissing or you have been pecking and you want to take it a step further, then you want to do what I call French kiss. French kiss is more passionate, it's more intense, it's more sensual. It means you want to take it to the next level, all right? Now, what are the benefits of kissing? I'll just run through this, all right? Now, kissing is a means of expression. Sometimes, that is why when I'm talking about, you know, the steps in kissing, you understand that. Sometimes when you don't want to, you don't want to talk, you don't want to say anything. You know, you just look at the person, you look at somebody you care so much about, and then you bring your mouth closer. Your kiss could say so much without you talking. So kissing is a mean of expression. It says a thousand words that you don't even need to verbalize. Your kiss is going to say it. So your kissing could mean a mean of expressing yourself, all right? And then a kiss may be an act of respect, all right? Now, it could be, for example, like there's something they said, I mean, there's a common saying, maybe I don't know if you know about that, but I think I know about that because of, by virtue of what I do, that men preferred to be kissed before lovemaking, and women prefer to be kissed after lovemaking. You know, women want to feel like, oh, he enjoyed it with me, so he wanted you to plant a kiss on her forehead and all that. So kissing may actually be an act of respect. Number three, kissing is beneficial to your health. You know, a kissing could actually give you strong heart. It could actually be a form of pain reliever. You know, because it is a great way to, you know, if you kiss and you kiss intensely, passionately, emotionally, it relieves, you know, it relieves muscle, you know, it is a kind of stress relief. You know, after a hard day work, you just take your time and you want to have a passionate French kiss. It's a kind of stress relief. It relieves the muscles and it could actually reduce pain. Number four, a kiss helps you to spice up your relationship. You know, what are you talking about? Why? People don't understand that people can ejaculate with kissing. You could kiss somebody and the person will have an orgasm. When you kiss, you enjoy it when it's passionate and when it's interesting, when it's fulfilling. You know, your facial muscle you know, they feel relaxed, and it helps you to smoothen them, and at the end of the day, it helps to smoothen your skin. So I'm giving you 12 reasons why I think kissing is good for you. These are the benefits of kissing that I've given you. I've given you 12 reasons. Now, another point I want to make here is this. If you're a bad kisser and you marry a good kisser or vice versa, you might never enjoy sex in that marriage. Because somebody who loves to kiss, who understands the impact, who understands the French kiss, what French kiss can do to you, who understands all these benefits that I've mentioned, will always be looking forward to it. And we not want to get down into lovemaking without the passionate French kiss. Now, if you now get married to that kind of a person, and all you want to do is forget kissing, let's just get down, that person will never enjoy sex, whether male or female. Now, the fact that a man is ejaculating does not mean that he's getting quality sex. Men also want to feel good. It's not about, is he not a man? So far, we come now. It's not just about coming. The man want to have quality sex. So if it's a man that loves to kiss and the wife doesn't like it, forget it. Your sex life is already about 70% reduced because the man is always looking forward to that. The same thing means vice versa. So now, a good kisser marrying a bad kisser could be the problem you are actually facing in your marriage. Now, what is the difference between a good kisser and a bad kisser? Now, a good kisser takes his time, but a bad kisser rushes and make a mess. A bad kisser, I'm going to still talk about that. You don't need too much saliva when you are kissing. But a bad kisser will make a mess. And he will make a mess because he's trying to rush. Now, a good kisser understands that the slower, the better. Now, it doesn't mean that maybe when you are not making love, it could get intense, it could increase. But come on, if it's an act of foreplay, if you want to get someone into the mood, if you want to pass a message across, the slower, the better. You take your time. Kissing is not what you rush to do because, okay, let me just quickly kiss. No. If you are doing that, you're a bad kisser. You need to take your time. A good kisser takes its time, and a bad kisser rushes and make a mess. Number two, a good kisser makes his lips wet. A bad kisser has a rough and unattractive lips. Now, even if you are not preparing to have a French kiss, you just find yourself wanting to kiss, you can actually easily lip your, you know, remove, you know, quickly remove all the sharps and use your saliva to smoothen your lips. You do that in seconds before kissing itself. So, if you're a good kisser, you understand that your lips is very important. It shouldn't be rough. It shouldn't be untidy. You should understand that your lips should be, there are a lot of things I'm going to be talking about that you could do to make your lips more attractive. But beyond that, even if it's impromptu, use your mouth and quickly, you know, suck your lips, you know, smoothen it and wet your lips. So a good kisser makes his lip wet, but a bad kisser has rough and unattractive lips. Number three, a good kisser makes slow movements. A bad kisser is always rushing. Now, it's related to my first point. My first point says a good kisser takes his time. Now, taking your time now might actually now be different a little bit from my number three point that said a good kisser makes slow movement. Now, taking your time means you want to look. I'm going to be talking about the steps, you know. You want to take your time to look. You gaze at the person you want to kiss before you even move closer, before you lean closer. It is not just about bring mouth. No, you take your time, you know. So a good kisser makes slow movement. And beyond taking your time, now number three is saying you are also slow. You know, gently. You do it like you mean it. You kiss like you mean it. So you make slow movement. Number three, a good kisser is soft and gentle. A bad kisser is rough and impatient. I want to kiss, you know. Yeah, the teeth, everything is just touching them, you know. A good kisser is soft and gentle. Even when the Oh gosh, I wish I could demonstrate this tonight. Even when a good kisser is probably trying to, you know, bring the partner closer, you know, even bringing the hand, looking at the face, you know, everything is done softly and gently. Number five, a good kisser swallows well before making an open mouth kiss, but a bad kisser is overly wet. Now, if you have plenty of saliva in your mouth and you're a good kisser, as soon as you know that that mouth is about to touch your partner's mouth, you swallow. That is a good kisser. But a bad kisser will carry all the saliva and put it. So you just start understanding where you are making a mistake and where you are getting it all wrong. All right? Number six, a good kisser uses his tongue delicately and sensually, but a bad kisser uses his tongue forcefully and overly well. You know, in French kiss, I'm going to demonstrate that later. You know, you need your tongue, you need your lips, you need your mouth. You know, so you want to roll the tongue around your partner's tongue at some point. Now, if you are a good kisser, you use your tongue slowly and skillfully, sensually and delicately. But a bad kisser uses his tongue. You're just shooking your tongue inside another person's mouth. You're turning her off. Funny enough, if you're not a good kisser, and you are kissing someone, and that's the worst. That's one funny thing about... Sorry, men. But that's one funny thing. You know, if it's a woman that doesn't know how to kiss, she can, you know, women are more, you know, feminine, you know, calm, ladylike. You know, so she could want to, like, take it easy. But African men, Nigerian men, you know, they want to prove, I know how to kiss, I know how to kiss. And then you are putting your mouth, you are putting the tongue inside her tongue. And she's feeling like, what's this? And it could be vice versa, actually, but it's more common with men. Because, you know, a research shows that, you know, men want to use a lot of saliva because it's believed that testosterone, you know, the hormone that is responsible for sexual drive, is actually present in the saliva of men while kissing. You know, so it is believed, research shows that men want to pass some of those testosterone to women like a way of, I want you. So if I give her some testosterone, I will put her in the mood. You know, that's how the research put it. So it's like it's saying that that's what the man is saying in his head, consciously or unconsciously. Now, so this could make him want to use a lot of saliva, want to pull his tongue forcefully, but it makes you a bad kisser and it's a total turn off. And then number seven, a good kisser pay attention to his oral hygiene and the smell of his mouth. A bad kisser never takes note of his breath. Now, if you're a good kisser, you understand. That's why if you kiss passionately in 1 week, in 2 weeks, in 1 month, I'm telling you, you could still be feeling the mouth of that person. If you kiss passionately, you could still be feeling, you know, there's a feeling you have in your mouth. It's bringing back the memory of that particular kiss. So if you're a good kisser, you understand that you can't eat suya and onions and alcohol and cigarettes, and then you want to put your mouth in another person's mouth. If you are a good kisser, you will understand that all these little things count. And some of you feel like, the rules are so many now, do this, do that. All these things, you know, it's something, that things that you apply to your life and they just flow effortlessly. It becomes a part of you and you just do them without stress, all right? And then, a bad kisser, of course, never pay attention to how his mouth is smelling. Probably smelling garlic or smelling ginger, smelling alcohol. He or she doesn't care. But if you're a good kisser, you pay attention to the way your mouth is smelling because you know there is a way you want it to taste. There's a way you want it to smell from your partner. And you know what you want. And then you won't want to give something otherwise to your partner. So if you are a good kisser, you pay attention to your hygiene, oral hygiene. A good kisser give time to breathe, and a bad kisser try to choke his partners. Now, when you are kissing, I'm going to talk about that. Okay, let me not delve into that, but I'm going to talk about that. But sometimes, if you lock up your mouth, it is possible that your partner or one of you or both of you might be trying to catch your breath. Now, if you are a good kisser, You understand that after locking your mouth for maybe few seconds or few minutes, you can just sensually pull away, slowly pull away a little bit, let the other party catch his or her breath, and then before you come back again, you know, it flows. The person will not even know that you are pulling. You know, you just imagine the two of you are good and you know how to do that. You know, so a good kisser gives time for the partner to breathe. For both of you to breathe, but a bad kisser doesn't even know he's choking you. That's why when the person removes his mouth, I mean, how can you be kissing and you are panting? All right, because it could actually if you are not careful, it could block your breath. You know, block your nose. I mean, your mouth is locked up, and it's blocking your nose. I mean, you will be trying to catch your breath. But if you are a good kisser, you understand all those tricks. All right. A good kisser makes the best of the kissing moment. That's my number 9. A bad kisser rushes, probably to get into other acts. Now, when you see a good kisser, it's all about, I want to enjoy this. I want to savour this. I want to make the best of this. It is more about that than for a bad kisser who is thinking, let's quickly kiss so I could sleep with him or so I could sleep with her. Do you get it? Even if you have intention of having sex or taking it a step further, funny enough, what you don't understand is if you do the kissing, if you perform the act of kissing very well, now that thing, the sex you are trying to rush, will just flow effortlessly. Only if you knew that you don't need to rush the kissing because you want to get down. Because if you perform the kissing very well, getting down becomes a icing on the cake because the person will be carried away already. So a bad kisser doesn't understand that he wants to do it so that he's thinking, I want to get down. But a good kisser make the best of the kissing moment. You understand that it is all about this 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes you want to stay kissing, right? And then number 10, a good kisser understands the importance of the before and after kiss. Now, but a bad kisser, careless. Now, a good kisser understands that you don't just move and put your mouth. You understand that there are things that need to be done before kissing. And he understands that there are things that need to be done after kissing. So he just doesn't put his mouth and pull away. No. You know, it takes his time. He looks at you. He caresses you. He touches you. He does all that before moving in. And after moving in, even after pulling away, he still tries to touch your hair. He still tries to rub your neck. He still tries to hold your... Even when you are moving away, you know, maybe moving away, the face is moving. He's touching the hair or she is touching the back of the neck. And you are still moving away, is still bringing the man back, you know, a little peck on the lip, bringing the man back, still drawing your hand, you know. The detachment doesn't just happen like that, you know, it takes time. You know, a good kisser understand that, but a bad kisser careless of the before and after. And then number 11, you feel loved and wanted when you kiss a good kisser, but you feel used and assaulted when you kiss a bad kisser. Now, if you kiss a good kisser, you feel loved, you feel wanted, you feel important, you feel interesting. But if you kiss a bad kisser, because the man is all about, or the woman is all about, kiss, let's just, you feel used and you feel assaulted. Even if that is not the intention, but because the person is a bad kisser, he doesn't understand all these cues, the person could make you to feel used and assaulted. All right? Those are my 11 difference between a good kisser and a bad kisser. Now, I want to tell you the steps involved in French kiss. I just wish I could finish this tonight. I don't think so. All right?
To enjoy more of this our Ogonge videos when you just watch, press this button to subscribe on top of our YouTube page. You go love her.